Good evening, everybody.
Hello.
Hope you're having a great day. Welcome to the Castro Files. Welcome back.
Yes. What's your name? Took a week off.
Who are you?
I'm Beth.
And I'm Greg. And that's Beth Castro, i.e. the Castro Files. So Castro, LaMontagne. Have you ever thought about having a show? You actually have a show named after you, technically.
I mean, you named it.
It's kind of cool, though. Anyway, welcome to the show. We've got some fun, spooky things to talk about. Tonight's a little different.
Right.
Today, whatever you're watching this, is a little bit different. So mine, we're going UFO.
Okay.
UFO stories up in New Hampshire. You don't think about New Hampshire having a lot of UFO sightings.
No.
But there's a pretty significant one that happened back in 1965.
Mm-hmm.
And then one that involves an actual family member of mine.
Right.
That I've got the newspaper article clippings from, and I'll share them and I'll be showing them on the show tonight. So it's pretty cool. So what are you going over tonight?
Mine is messages from the other side. Emails from the other side.
Oh, that's... Yeah, we're going to get into that. Yeah. That's got to be creepy, right?
Yeah,
you start thinking like, oh no.
Yes. You're like, wait, what?
Right? So first foremost, thank you guys for joining again. As I said before, go out, like, subscribe to the Castro Files channel or on The Bar Is Open with Beth and Greg. We share this both out there. Mm-hmm. We post these, the Castro Files, once a week, every Sunday. Depends on when we upload it or when we want to release it, but sometime on Sunday, generally in the morning. But you can find us there. You can also go out to Minor League Studios, check out the merch. We've got a cool scary kitty shirt coming, so that'll be pretty fun, just in time for Halloween.
Just in time for Halloween.
So it'll be fun. Yeah. It's going to be good. Yeah. So with that, let's jump into this. What do you say?
Let's do it.
All right. So again, like I had said, my first story is related to UFOs and UFO sightings in New Hampshire. And one was called the Exeter Incident. So Exeter, New Hampshire is maybe 15 miles, not even quite 15 miles, 10 miles inland from the coast. Mm-hmm. There's 12 miles of beach mm-hmm. in New Hampshire, about 10, 15 miles inland. I grew up in Hampton, New Hampshire, which is right along the seacoast, about a mile and a half, 2 miles from the beach, and grew up at the beach all the time, right?
Right.
I don't remember ever really hearing about this story, which is interesting.
How old would you have been?
65.
Oh, no. I thought you were talking about the other story. So you've never heard of this story either, when you lived there.
So it was definitely around,
okay,
but I just don't know that I paid attention.
Right.
And my cousin Katie today, when I was trying to find the pictures again from my aunts,
She reminded
me about it, and I was like, oh, yeah, it's a big thing up there. They do an annual festival every year, and they just brought it back this year, actually.
Oh, okay.
So you can go out and look up the Exeter Incident. I'm going to be going off of basically a Wikipedia page for this that goes into pretty good detail on it, and it gets into kind of a bit of conspiratorial stuff, interestingly enough. So put on your tinfoil hats because it's going to be a fun one. So, all right, the Exeter Incident, or the Incident at Exeter, was a highly publicized UFO sighting that occurred on September 3rd, 1965, approximately 5 miles south of Exeter, New Hampshire, in the neighboring town of Kensington. So this is all seacoast. This is all place we used to drive around and as kids get lost and, you know, try and get lost, right?
Right.
It's fun. Cool place. Although several separate sightings had been made in the area by numerous witnesses in the weeks leading up to the specific incident, it was the September 3rd sighting, which eventually became by far the most famous, involving a local teenager and two police officers. Huh. 2011, Skeptical Inquirer offered an explanation of the incident based on detailed reports by eyewitnesses. So the sightings, this is where we get into what they actually saw. On September 3rd, at approximately 2 a.m., 18-year-old Norman Muscarello was hitchhiking to his home in Exeter along Route 150, New Hampshire Route 150. Muscarello had graduated from high school 3 months earlier and was 3 weeks away from leaving for service in the United States Navy. He'd been visiting his girlfriend at her parents' home in nearby Amesbury, Mass. Since he did not own a car, Muscarello would hitchhike to and from Amesbury, a distance about 10 miles. However, at that hour of the morning, there was little traffic on the highway, so he had walked a good part of the distance. After reaching Kensington, a few miles outside Exeter, Muscarello noticed 5 flashing bright red lights in the distance, which he initially thought might be the lights of a police car or fire engine. As he drew nearer to the lights, he saw that they were hovering in the air just above the trees and illuminated a nearby field and two houses in brilliant red light. One house belonged to the Dining family, who were not at home at the time. The other to a family named Russell. Muscarello estimated the object to be about 80 to 90 feet in diameter. He became terrified as the object. Go ahead.
That's big.
It's pretty, 80, yeah. 90 feet. Yeah, absolutely. That's good size, right?
Yeah.
He became terrified as the object, which made absolutely no sound, began to move steadily towards him. Panicking, he dived into the ditch beside the road. The lights changed direction and hovering over the dining farmhouse, Muscarello ran to the Russell's house, pounded on the door, and yelled for help, but nobody answered. The Russells later stated they heard Muscarello at the door, but were too frightened to open it. 2 a.m., somebody's beating on your door, right? Like, that's a call the cops.
Well, you're probably saying, help! I guess you still don't know what...
We didn't have Ring doorbells back then, right? You're not exactly like, what do you want, right?
Yeah, how can I help you?
Yeah, you know. And that part of the area is it's heavily wooded. Right. We're going to New Hampshire next week. You're familiar with the place. It's lots of winding roads through the woods and stuff like that.
Right.
So you wouldn't necessarily
open your door to just anyone.
Just a random hitch. Yeah, right. Yeah. So the object then moved away and disappeared into the nearby woods. Seeing the headlights of an approaching car, Muscarello ran into the road and forced it to stop. The couple in the car drove the frightened youth to Exeter Police Station. At the police station, Muscarello, pale and visibly shaken, told his story to Officer Reginald Toland, who worked the night desk. Toland knew Muscarello and was impressed by his obvious fear and genuinely agitated state. Toland radioed police officer Eugene Bertrand Jr., who earlier in the evening had passed a distressed woman sitting in her car on New Hampshire 108. When Bertrand stopped to ask if she had a problem, the woman told me that a huge object with flashing red lights had followed her from Epping, 12 miles away.
Wow.
And hovered over her car before flying away. Bertrand considered her a kook, in quotes, but did stay with her for approximately 15 minutes until she had calmed down and was ready to resume her drive. After arriving at the police station and hearing Muscarello's story, Bertrand decided to drive back to the dining farm with Muscarello to investigate the field where he had seen the lights. So now we're going to get into the officer's perspective on it. So,
is the kid with him?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, so he brought him back to probably explain, try and go through like
the story.
What happened? Like, what really?
The incident.
Are you just being, but if it's, you start having corroboration right?
Two people saying the same thing.
Yeah, so Bertrand, so this is officers Bertrand and Hunt. And you can find this, like I said, out on Wikipedia. Bertrand drove Muscarello back to the area of his sighting. From Bertrand's patrol car, they at first saw nothing unusual. However, when they left the car and walked into the field and towards the woods where Muscarello had first seen the lights, some horses in the nearby corral began kicking the fence and sides of the barn, making loud, frightened noises. Dogs in the area began to bark and howl. Bertrand and Muscarello then saw an object slowly rise from the trees beyond the corral. Bertrand described the UFO as this huge dark object as big as the barn over there, as he, you know, mentions, with red flashing lights on it. The object that moved silently towards them, swaying back and forth. Instinctively remembering his police training, Bertrand dropped to one knee, drew his revolver, and pointed it at the object. I'm like...
I mean, that's what your head tries to make sense.
Yeah, you know? I mean, that's your only defense. At least you got that.
Right.
Otherwise, what are you going to pick up? Like a stick?
A rock?
It's a UFO in there. Yeah. Exactly. Right? So he then decided that shooting at it would not be wise. Probably a good idea, right? So he reholstered the revolver, grabbed Muscarello, and both ran back to his patrol car. Bertrand radioed another Exeter policeman, David Hunt, for assistance. And while the two waited in the car for Hunt to arrive, they continued to observe the object. According to UFO historian Jerome Clark, Bertrand and Muscarello observed the object as it hovered 100 feet away and at 100 feet altitude, rocked back and forth. The pulsating red lights flashed in a rapid sequence, first from right to left, then left to right, each cycle consuming no more than 2 seconds. The local animals continued to act agitated. The object was still there when Hunt arrived, and he also watched it. The object finally rose over the trees and disappeared. Hunt soon heard engines of a B-47 bomber as it flew overhead.
Shit.
And he later told journalist John G. Fuller that you could tell the difference between the UFO and the bomber. There was no comparison. All three men drove back to the Exeter police station and immediately filed separate reports on what they had seen. Bertrand then drove Muscarello home and told his mother about the incident. So there's an Air Force base that was a fully commissioned Air Force base. It's called Pease Air Force Base. It's since been decommissioned. Now it's like just Pease International Airport or something like that. It's like got all sorts of restaurants and you can, you know, all sorts of different things on it now.
Oh, that's cool.
But back in the day, it was a major Air Force base. It was huge, right?
Okay.
So that's when is where kind of the Air Force starts getting into some of this.
Okay.
So Air Force investigation and explanation. When Exeter's police chief read the reports of Bertrand, Hunt, and Muscarello, he called nearby Pease Air Force Base and reported a UFO sighting. The Air Force sent Major David Griffin and Lieutenant Alan Brandt to interview the three men. The Air Force officers asked all three men not to report their sightings to press, but a reporter from the Manchester Union Leader newspaper had already interviewed them.
Okay.
Major Griffin sent a report of the incident to the staff of the Project Blue Book, which is a whole nother conspiracy kind of avenue you could go down. If you want to dig into that, it's all sorts of crazy. The official Air Force research group assigned to investigate UFO reports. That's Project Blue Book.
Okay.
Part of some of the stuff that they've started releasing in the past couple of years, like the, what do they call the Tic Tac and the, I don't remember the one that kind of turns around. I can't think of the name of it right off the top of my head. So Griffin wrote at that at this time I had been unable to arrive at a probable cause of the sighting. The three observers seemed to be stable, reliable persons, especially the two patrolmen. I viewed the area of the sighting and found nothing in the area that could be the probable cause. Pease Air Force Base had 5 B-47 aircraft flying that night in the area, but I do not believe that they had any connection with this sighting.
Okay. They were just flying.
They were just in
the
air.
Just happenstance.
You got to think, it's 1965, right?
Right.
You're in Vietnam. We've got that going on. You've got there's all sorts of tensions happening, right?
Mm-hmm.
So before Project Blue Book could send this evaluation to the Pentagon, however, the Air Force had already issued an explanation of Muscarello and the two policemen's sighting to the press. The Pentagon informed reporters that the three men had seen nothing more than stars and planets twinkling. Owing it to temperature inversion.
Yes.
There's another. I lived in New Hampshire for
years. What did they say? Stars and.
And planets twinkling.
Okay, there's a difference between a twinkling and 5 red lights.
And a 90 foot.
And 5 red lights. I'm just saying.
Just like, it's just. No, it's a football field, or half a football field, basically.
But it's just planets and twinkling stars.
Yeah, right? Yeah. So I love it.
Nice try.
So Project Blue Book then issued its own explanation stating that Operation Big Blast, a SAC-NORAD training mission, had been active on the night of the sighting and that it could have accounted for the UFO. Project Blue Book's supervisor, U.S. United States Air Force Major Hector Quintanilla.
Quintanilla?
Thank you.
Yeah.
Wrote policemen Bertrand and Hunt that in addition to the aircraft from this Operation Big Blast, there were also 5 B-47 aircraft flying in your area during that period. Since there were many aircraft in the area at the time, and there were no reports of unidentified objects from personnel engaged in this operation, we might then assume that the object you observed between midnight and 2 might be associated with this military air operation. Quintanilla, I got it that time. Also, also added that if, however, these aircraft were noted by either of you, this would tend to eliminate this air operation as possible explanation for these objects. So they're saying if you had seen those airplanes,
that's what you saw.
Then, and it wasn't the airplanes, then it probably was something else. It was probably that UFO. But since you didn't see the airplanes, it must have been the airplanes. See how they're playing that?
They just make you feel crazy.
That's kind of a...
Because that sounds crazy when I hear you say it. So it either... If I saw the airplanes, then it was the airplanes. But if I didn't see the airplanes, then it was UFO.
Right. Kind of crazy, right?
Yeah.
So a little bit more on this. So basically, the Air Force came back and said it was you didn't see anything for the most part, right?
Okay.
And the Air Force, so Muscarella, Bertrand, and Hunt all strongly disagreed with the Air Force explanation. Then the two policemen sent a letter to Project Blue Book in which they stated, as you can imagine, we have been the subject of considerable ridicule since the Pentagon released its final, in quote, evaluation of our sighting on September 3rd, 1965. In other words, both Patrolman Hunt and myself saw this object at close range, checked it out with each other, confirmed and reconfirmed that it was not any type of conventional aircraft, and went to considerable trouble to confirm that the weather was clear, there was no wind, no chance of weather inversion, and that we were seeing that what we were seeing was in no way a military or civilian craft.
Right.
Bertrand also noted that their UFO sighting took place nearly an hour after Operation Big Blast was said to have ended.
Okay.
Right. So they didn't even have an overlap time.
Right.
So especially when you...
So then explain the B-52 then. Like
the B-47s?
I mean, the B-47s. If the operation was over, did they send that out because they knew something was in the air?
Right.
Yep.
So if it's on radar, they may have, right?
Yeah.
And you got it. Like I said, New Hampshire isn't that big. No. Like it would take 10 minutes to go from Pease Air Force Base to where this is by air.
Excuse me, I'm sorry.
You know, and you're going a couple hundred miles an hour in a plane.
Right.
Right, or however fast those things fly, right?
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's very interesting. So the aftermath, the Exeter UFO sightings, and particularly the initial sightings involving Norman Muscarello and police officers Eugene Bertrand and David Hunt, remain among the best documented and best publicized in UFO history.
Wow.
Give you a different perspective now that we're going and we drive for some long roads out in the middle of nowhere.
It's really dark up there.
Yeah, right. And you're just gonna be like looking up in the sky, right? Creeped out. So
I'm always looking for Bigfoot.
Well, that too. Yeah. It's Fuller published an account of his investigation into the case entitled Incident at Exeter. It made the New York Times bestseller list. Muscarello, who insisted for the rest of his life that what he had witnessed was real and not an ordinary object. He died in April of 2003 at age 55.
He died young.
Brief illness. He had an illness. Bertrand died in 98. Hunt in 2011. In 2010, the Exeter Kiwanis Club started the Exeter UFO Festival.
That's fun.
As a fundraiser to benefit children's charities in Exeter.
Oh, that's cool.
So I think it's great, right?
Yeah.
So now we're going to get into my aunt's stories real quick here, which is pretty interesting because the headline, this literally was my aunt back in the day, right? And I'll read the article, and I also have pictures of the article, and I'll post these for you guys. You guys can read them. So Hampton, it's approximately 10:15 p.m. And this is in this article right here, Tuesday, November 23rd, 1982. I think that's what it says. My eyesight works. Yeah, 1982. So, Hampton, it's approximately 10:15 on the night of Thursday, September 30th, 1982. Four local women are driving west on Exeter Road, a short distance past Hampton Machine Company. The driver of the car, Mary Ann Poland, 44, of Allison Drive in Seabrook. They get very specific on these, right? Yeah. It's a local newspaper.
Right.
Right. Notices what she takes to be an airplane coming in low over the trees. That, in quotes, she says, that airplane is flying very low, she remarks casually to her fellow companions. The other three women do not at first pay too much attention to Poland's remark until, that is, Poland shouts, "That's not an airplane. Look at it." The four women then stare in amazement at the strange craft gliding in the sky above them at treetop level. The huge craft, later described as big as a house, could be clearly seen in the night sky, moving slowly away from them towards a house on the southerly side of the road. Its oval shape is easily discernible as the entire craft is ringed with flashing red and white lights. "Stop the car, Mary LaMontagne, 29 of P Street, Hampton Beach," yells from her limited vantage point in the back seat. "I grew up at that in that area. That's was my family's house on P Street, right? So Poland begins to apply the brakes before she can come to a full stop. Lamontagne and Rose Messina, 25, also of P Street, hop out of the car, seemingly oblivious to the dangers of jumping from moving from the moving vehicle. Poland and Nikki LeClaire, 53, of Park Avenue in Hampton, watch in disbelief as their two friends vanish into the darkness up a nearby driveway. All right, so if you know my aunts, so my Aunt Mary and my Aunt Rose, they are absolutely the type that would jump out of the car and go running to that. Absolutely.
Yeah. I think it runs in the Lamontagne blood.
It's just one of those things. It's hilarious. So Lamontagne and Messina, fleeing totally without fear or apprehension, dash the length of the driveway, reach the edge of the patch of woods, and then stare in awe as the inexplicable object of their attention comes into stop almost directly above them. This is fire in the sky, almost, right? Like, they just didn't get taken.
They just didn't get abducted, right? Thank goodness.
Both women stand completely still, enthralled with the massive craft, its flashing lights, and a larger ray of light which beams down like a path to the sky. As later described by Lamontagne, for a brief few seconds, Lamontagne and Messina watch the object, which hovers soundlessly so close above them, the only noise being the soft rustle of leaves in the wind. Then the craft begins to move again, sliding silently away from them to the protective awestruck woman. Protective cover of the woods. In an instant, it's gone. And the two awestruck women suddenly realize that the porch light has been snapped on at a nearby house. They turn and run back to the car, anxious companions in the car. Later, after discussing what they had seen, they came to the only obvious conclusion. They had experienced an extremely close encounter with an unidentified flying object. The above story. So here is a picture of the drawing that they did for it. Let me kill this one. You got to keep in mind, we didn't have iPads and everything. Right. You just draw stuff out. There hadn't been a lot of, like, you didn't have the internet to search. So the newspaper was the way to put information out there.
Right.
That was pretty much, and then chronicling things, right? So this was their drawing that they sketched out. The above story, reconstructed from information supplied by the four women during a recent interview, does not end there. Lamontagne, was an employee at the time of New England Telephone, as are the three others, had been especially affected by the encounter and claims that she had received telepathic messages from the craft and or its occupants. "They want me to be healthy," she told the newspaper, explaining she had recently quit smoking after indulging in 2.5 packs a day for the past 14 years. Lamontagne claims she had no desire to smoke, and her three friends are all equally amazed at her uncanny ability to quit cold turkey, adding credence to the possibility of outside influence. Hmm. When asked why she felt the need to be healthy, Lamontagne explained, I felt because they stopped, they wanted me to do something. I sensed that it was okay and that they were not here to hurt us. I just know there's more, but I don't know when." All four women informed this newspaper that what they saw was definitely a UFO. "I saw a huge oval object, which was very bright. The fact that it made no noise astounded me," Messina said. The other three women also described the object in very similar terms. Neither Lamontagne or Messina, however, could explain why they felt compelled to chase the object and risk their safety by jumping from the moving vehicle. So it's pretty cool, you know, when you kind of go like, all right, I think it was at last night. I think it was, we were just talking and you go, all right, if there's UFOs out there, why have I never seen one? Right?
It was last night.
And you're like, just might not.
If I see one, I want my experience to be like theirs. I do not want to be abducted. I do not want to be taken up and tested on. I just want to see it, because I got to see it to believe it.
You don't want any probing happening, like that. Because we did listen to
we watched that shock doc about the guy who wrote Communion.
Yeah,
which is based off a true story of a guy, a gentleman, an author. He was an actual author, like a published, well-known author that was taken from his bedroom.
Sounds horrific.
He wrote, because they have the tapes that play with
hypnosis that goes with it.
The hypnosis tapes, and it sounds Like, he's reliving it all over again. And in the actual interview, he's like, I'm sorry, I can't listen to this. It brings back too many memories of how terrified I was. So his wife was actually the one who encouraged him to write
the book
based off his
experience. And people started coming out and talking.
Well,
and
just, if you guys haven't seen it, it's on Discovery Plus.
Yeah.
I can't remember the name of it right now, but it was really good. So if I ever had to, I would love to see a UFO the way that your aunts, I just said it like you said it, your aunts experienced it, where you actually get to see it, maybe feel
from
it.
From afar,
maybe. Feel something, but I don't need to be taken abroad.
Taken aboard. So this is a picture of...
To another galaxy.
Oh, to another galaxy.
I don't need to go.
I'd rather go to another galaxy than be like... tested on.
Yeah.
Like, just take me, let's go see Saturn.
I mean, I don't even know if I need to, I don't want either of those. I just want to see you and say
peace
out.
It'd be pretty cool to go to
deuces.
As long as they bring me back.
I was going to say, would it? Because what if they don't bring you back?
I don't know.
What if they're like, we ran out of gas, you're stuck with us now.
Is that a thing?
I don't know.
UFOs run out of gas?
We don't know what
I hope
technology
not.
Is,
so this
right?
is my aunts and their friends that I named before. My aunt is standing on the far right, and my other aunt is right beside her, Rose. So that's that. The articles, like I said, I'll post them out if you want to see them. Here's the first one I just read. And the second one right here. So it's this continuation.
Okay.
So always, I'm excited. You go back to New Hampshire. It's such a historical place.
Do they say when
the
festival is?
I'll look it up.
Okay,
let me find out.
That would be fun to go sometime.
Yeah, let me find out, and I'll see if I can.
I'm glad it's still going on all these years later. Yeah.
So very cool, though. Yeah. If I can find something, I'll let you know on that. But yeah, so that's in Exeter, New Hampshire. There's not a lot of stories that come out of.
They were both in Exeter.
Well, that one was in Exeter, and they were in So this is. Let me give you.
So what were your aunts?
I'll give you an.
Okay.
So. In New Hampshire, you have a road. It's called Hampton Road and Exeter Road.
Okay.
They're the same road.
Oh, they just
in
changed
Hampton,
names.
In Hampton, it's called Exeter Road.
Okay.
In Exeter, it's called Hampton Road.
Oh, that's hilarious.
Right? There were high school rivals.
Oh,
right?
Okay.
Because they're so close to each other.
And it's such a small town, they had nothing else to name the streets.
Evidently. I mean, the town was like incorporated in like 1636 or something like that, right? You know,
the whole state's flipping small.
It's old. It's very, very old.
It's very haunted.
It's
too.
Very interesting. So, what do you got today?
So, I'm going to be reading a story from. It's called "The Ghost Stories: True Crimes, Paranormal Stories, Demon Encounters, Poltergeists, and Unsolved Cases" by Hannah J. Tidy. Tidy? T-I-D-Y? Tidy, probably.
Tidy,
Like I said, this is Emails from the Other Side is the name of the story.
Cool.
And a unique and relatively recent incident, Jack, and these are all based off, like, these are stories this author has gotten from people.
Okay, cool.
A unique and relatively recent incident, Jack Froh's story told through personal accounts of those touched by it. The story can be one of horror as well as joy, depending on how you would personally cope with and view the death of someone close to you. Some may find it deeply deeply unsettling or horrifying, while others would find solace in the experience if they have to have lost someone dear to them. Either way, everybody will agree that the freak occurrence described by Froh's friends and family is incredibly strange. So Jack Froh was, in the other words of his loved ones, a kind, sensitive, and well-liked man living in Dunmore in the state of Pennsylvania. Unfortunately, he passed away at the young age of 32 in June of 2011. So this isn't that old.
Okay.
He passed away due to heart problems.
11 years ago.
Yeah. He passed away due to heart problems, arrhythmic complications in particular. His death was very sudden and shocked to those around him, leaving them with much grief. He was survived by his mom, Patty Froh, his longtime friend, Tim Hart, and his cousin, Jimmy McGraw, with whom he was close to as well. Jack's friends and family began to accept the loss and cope with it as best as they could, moving on with their lives and coming to terms with life without him. This way of dealing with death would have been an ordinary story for human loss, grief, and letting go of someone special, had it not been for the bizarre events that began to occur a few months after Jack's death. In November of 2011, Tim Hart and Jimmy McGraw were each stunned to receive separate emails from their deceased friend's email account. The messages were rather personal and referred to some of the final conversations and situations they found themselves in with Jack, not long before his untimely death. These unique details infused the email with extraordinary level of credibility and authenticity, which made it very difficult for his friends to brush them off as a big prank by someone who had hacked into Jack's email account.
So, quick question. What did he, did it say what he died of? I'm sorry.
Yeah, heart attack.
A heart attack.
Heart issues.
So that's not, so, okay, so.
It was very sudden.
I heard it, yeah, so it wasn't something that was like cancer, no. Where it's like, it's ongoing, you're like,
no.
I can he set didn't. Like a, I drop dead kind of date,
right.
Like, and it's going to release.
Nope, nope.
You know what I mean?
Sudden heart attack, unbeknownst to him.
I was like, yeah.
He, you know, he didn't heart know disease. He had heart issues. Yeah. He just yeah. basically.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, let's see. Both Tim Hart and Jimmy McGraw also believe, as they have stated in an interview given to the BBC, that nobody could have possibly known the password for Jack's email account, and a case of cyber hacking was doubtful. Both Hart and McGraw discussed and showed the contents of the emails they received from the deceased in the BBC TV interview. The message that Hart received stood out in his email inbox not only because of the deceased sender, but also due to its eerie subject title, which concisely stated, "I'm watching." When Tim Hart first saw the message, he remembered he turned white as a sheet with utter disbelief. After the initial shock had faded, yeah right, and after he got a grip on himself and his emotions, he opened the email, greeted by the familiar, lighthearted tone of voice in the email message characteristics of Jack Froese he knew and loved. The message from Jack read, "Do you hear me? I'm at your house. Clean your effing attic."
Oh, Jesus. Dude, I'm totally doing this to one of my friends. If I die.
When you pass on?
Yeah, okay.
The message were especially shocking in Tim's sense.
Only I'm going to send text messages.
Oh, well, okay.
Just like ping, ping, like 2 o'clock in the morning. Chuck.
Yeah, just send a bunch of them.
He just hates everything in the morning.
Yeah. So the message were especially shocking to Tim since it wasn't long before his friend's death. The message was especially shocking to Tim since it wasn't long before his friend's death. Jack commented jokingly on how Tim's attic was in desperate need of cleaning up. They had a conversation in a private setting, and Hart says that nobody else knew about it and would possibly even think of saying such a thing in an email. He was unaware what to make of the message, but he still replied to the email, hoping to elicit some kind of response from beyond the grave. Unfortunately, no answer that we know of ever came back. Likewise, the email sent to Jimmy McGraw pertained to his matter as well, but this time regarding issues that occurred after Jack's death in the June of 2011. McGraw explains in the interview that he broke his ankle about a week before the received email in November of 2011 on his way to work. The message McGraw received, Jack asked how he was doing and told him he knew he was going to sustain his injury and he tried to warn him. Jack then said to him, Jim ought to be careful, made a couple of short personal remarks, and ended with his name as the signature. McGraw noted that when he was recovering following his ankle injury and accident, he saw very few people, which only included a couple of friends and a few family members. Despite the initial bewilderment brought about by the eerie personal emails from their dearly departed friend, the people Jack left behind soon came to terms with what had happened. Of course, it remains unclear whether this bizarre correspondence was a very distasteful and cool prank or actual documented communication with the deceased Jack Froese from the realm beyond our own. Many people would probably be very disturbed if they received any sort of message or a perceived sign from their dead loved ones. But this wasn't the case with the folks that Jack had left behind in Dunmore, Pennsylvania. Jack Froese's mother, Patty, told the interview that the emails delighted some people while they disturbed others. She accepted them with an open heart and said Jack's loved ones, that the message were a gift from him and that they should take them as such.
Yeah.
She didn't give much thought to whether or not they were just a cruel prank. Instead, she was grateful for the mere fact that these mysterious email got people to keep talking about her son and kept his memory alive. Hart and McGraw were on a very similar mindset as his mother. Hart said he didn't care whether it was a prank or not. Hart wholeheartedly accepted the advice from Jack's mother, saying he would take the mystery the way he wanted to, but accepted as a good thing in the end. McGraw had very similar feelings and described how hard he was hit by his cousin's sudden departure, explaining McGraw viewed the emails as Jack's attempt to help him feel better and move on from his death. He concluded that he liked the fact that he received the mysterious and unexplained emails in the first place. Dealing with death and loss is such a personal and subjective experience that we each must go through it our own way. This story has a profound effect on the audience since it can be a very personal experience. It's possible someone they knew sent the emails. Who would ever think of pulling such a nasty joke on their friends? But then again, we don't know if they were also somehow sent by Jack Froese from beyond the grave to tease his dear loved ones for one last time.
Either way, Jack's inner circle got something heartfelt out of the whole experience and found a sort of closure in the message, in the mysterious message, helping them move on. How would you feel receiving such an unexplained, eerie message from the realm of the unknown?
So
I think I would be like Jack's mom.
I would. I 100% would be the same way.
I would be like, you know what? They're wanting to make sure I'm okay. Especially trying to add some levity.
I mean, it would creep me out. I'd be like, what the hell?
What? For the first couple of days, I would probably be totally creeped out and freaked out. And then I would hope that I would put my arms around it.
But you go like, okay,
and be like, you know
what? This isn't like, he's just a normal guy that has great friends.
Right.
You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And it's not like, why would somebody target a dude like that died?
Right.
Right. To hack his email, to do something like that. I mean, you hack somebody to get the credit card information or something like, right?
Right, right, right.
You don't hack it to then prank
about their
the
addict,
two people.
You know, or that I know that, you fell.
You know what I mean? Like very specific things that like, okay, I've only told five people.
Yeah.
That I broke my ankle or
right.
Nobody select, knows my attic needs to be cleaned.
That's why they were saying there were very specific messages
and
that
you go, like, there's
other
just
people weren't involved
else.
In the conversation.
Yeah.
So even if someone had hacked his email, they wouldn't have known about the attic conversation.
Right. So that's where you go, oh, he's effing with me.
Yeah.
Right. He's a very kind of comforting.
Yeah.
Even though, like, to some people, it might be creepy, and they can't deal with it.
Right.
But to me,
I think I would be creeped out for a little while, and then I'd be like, you know what?
So you think about it, like, I've lost family members. We all have.
Right.
Right? It would be kind of cool. Like, don't bang something in the middle of the night. Send me a text.
Yes, or an email,
Don't throw something across my house to be like, I'm here. No, because that's creepy.
Surprise!
That, when it scares the dogs. Like, we don't need that now.
Right.
You send me a cool email, I might get to it.
Right.
Send it to my work email if you're going to do it, though.
Yeah.
I read those. I don't, you know. But, you know what I mean? Like, or send me a text.
That's funny.
But no, I agree. It's kind of one of those things.
I mean, it's a cool story. I think it probably would take a minute for wrap your arms around it and be comfortable with it.
Yeah.
But I love that they finally eventually took on the mom's mindset of, you know what, this is a gift.
Good. Yeah.
Take
and
it
you're
for
lucky
what it
to
is.
Have a situation.
Take it for what it is.
Yeah.
Where it's got us talking about him.
And it's got you and I talking
right.
about it. So that means his story keeps going on
right.
and on and on
yeah.
and on. You know, so it's very cool.
It was short and sweet, but I really liked
yeah,
it.
Yeah, absolutely. Very cool. Very cool.
Yeah.
So that's what we've got for you guys tonight. Thank you so much.
Hope you enjoyed the stories.
Smash that, hammer that like button. Subscribe, go out to the Castro Files on YouTube. This also goes out to the Bar Is Open podcast on audio to iTunes. Spotify, iHeartRadio, all the
Amazon,
places you can find Amazon. Yeah. Anywhere you can find an audio, this will go out to.
And give us a review.
We'd
love to hear what you guys think.
And let us know if there's stories that you guys have. If you've seen or know somebody that's
Message us on the Instagram.
Gotten an email or
seen an
UFO.
Alien or UFO.
If you've seen an alien, you're coming on the show.
Amen.
If you don't mind.
Yeah, that would be
all right.
Cool.
We love you guys. Thank you so much
Thanks,
again.
Guys.
Have a great night.
Have a great night.